joining us.
Thank you very, very much. I'm happy.
Ladies and gentlemen, Shri Kumar Kedkar is a renowned Indian journalist, writer, and a politician. He started his journalistic career with Economic Times. He has also been the editor-in-chief of the Marathi newspaper Lok Satta. He has also worked with The Observer and the Maharashtra Times. On 12 March 2018, he was nominated to the Rajya Sabha on a Congress ticket from Maharashtra, and currently he is a member of Parliament. He has written on various topics over the years and has also provided media coverage to 8 presidential elections in the US since 1988, the collapse of the Soviet Union in 1991, integration of Germany in 92, and the integration of Hong Kong with China in 97. He was the India coordinator for South Asian Free Media Association, Mumbai Karachi Forum. He has also received several prestigious awards for journalistic excellence like Padma Shri in 2001 and Indian Affairs, Transformational Journalist of the Decade, and many others. It's an honor to have you on our show, sir.
Well, I'm happy and I'm flattered.
Kumarji, we are governance now and we primarily talk of governance issues.
I know, I read your magazine. Yeah.
Yes, thank you so much. Since the past decade, how much points, or, you know, in your opinion, how would you rate the present day governance of this nation?
If I can afford to be blunt on your channel,
you can.
I don't think there is any governance now, at least past 1 year, that is after re-election of Narendra Modi in 2019, there was a lot of brouhaha, but less governance and more brouhaha. So actually governance has taken a backseat. Now you can blame, or somebody can blame, somebody who is sympathetic to the government or to Narendra Modi can say, well, actually the entire year 2020 virtually was lost in COVID, and therefore perhaps the things were bad. But actually the economic slowdown has begun earlier. That is almost immediately. So if the steps were taken immediately for controlling the economy or economic downfall, perhaps it could have been helpful. But I don't think the government was in sort of self-congratulatory mode for a long time, and therefore they thought they can do anything and get away with it. And so I think they ignored the economy, and now suddenly they have started disinvesting. And you know, LIC, to sell LIC, 74% of shares of LIC, clearly shows that the government is not in command, but the economy is dictating the terms of governance. And that is a very, very dangerous sign. Politics should dictate economy. Economy should not dictate politics. That has been my training ever since I started studying sociology and political sociology and so on, and started studying governance of various countries and visited so many countries. Actually, it would be incorrect to give analogy of Soviet Union, because Soviet Union was a communist country, monolithic communist party. It was completely governed only by bureaucracy and military and the party. And it collapsed. It disintegrated. I was there when it was disintegrating. Now, imagine there is no Adani Ambani there to destabilize their government. There is no exactly CIA trying to help them to get, you know, get their objective of destabilizing Soviet Union. Why did it get destabilized and disintegrated? It was because it became complacent. It became indifferent to the actual economic issues of governance. And when Gorbachev started his planning called Perestroika and Glasnost, Perestroika meant restructuring of the economy and glasnost meant democracy. Now, when he started democratizing through economy and economy through democratization of politics, it collapsed because it could not take it. Now, this is a wrong example, completely wrong analogy. However, one common element is there, that if you are complacent, if you are indifferent to the economy, then its impact on political governance is inevitable. That is what happened there. And that is what is happening here. Of course, the consequences can be different and are different.
Sure. Kumarji, now let's talk about the union budget 21-22. The government says focus on healthcare, infrastructure, technology makes this budget a growth-oriented one. Do you believe so? And it can get one of the most resilient economies, which is India, back on track?
I don't think so, because, you know, there's a lot of praise to this particular budget. But if you read carefully and read the fine print, you will realize that even in, for defense, they have added very little money. And defense is the main issue after the Galwan Valley affair. And China is now building villages even in Arunachal Pradesh. So at that point of time, at such a point of time, when Pakistan has not yet given up its aggressiveness when China has actually invaded. In America, the establishment has changed. And therefore, in such a situation, when India actually is quite cornered, even in South Asia. In 2014, when Narendra Modi came to power, he said, my approach is friendly neighborhood policy. He wanted entire neighborhood to be friendly. And what we have seen in last 6-7 years is Nepal has become hostile. Maldives has become hostile. Sri Lanka is not exactly friendly. Pakistan was always unfriendly. In fact, China, in question of China, Modi has visited the Chinese president 18 times in last 7 years, 18 times. He has visited China for 5 times. He has met him several times in international fora. And yet, it is China which has, according to him, betrayed the Indian Friendship Code. Now, I don't understand why this happened or why our entire foreign policy establishment, RAW, and the, you know, all the foreign intelligence agencies could not anticipate that China might do something. So I think it is complete, total failure of the intelligence, total failure of the foreign policy establishment to anticipate what China can do. And therefore, I think even in China, the so-called neighborhood policy has failed. All neighbors today are not exactly friendly or they are openly unfriendly with India. So that is big failure on the part of the government.
Now let's talk about the Aam Aadmi. You know, after all, the budget is for you and me as well as citizens of this nation. What does the Aam Aadmi derive out of it?
Well, actually, they can say that they have not taxed anybody additionally.
But there are no concessions as well.
No, but you know, interesting, when we talk of Aam Aadmi, particularly on a channel like this, essentially English channel, mainly listeners are English, we are essentially talking to the middle class, educated middle class. We are not talking to a tribal in Bastar or Gadchiroli. We are not talking to a landless laborer. We are not talking even to an educated farmer. Forget uneducated farmer. About 60% of the farming community in India is landless. So when we are talking like this, the Aam Aadmi, definition of Aam Aadmi changes. Definition of Aam Aadmi, if you take to this particular chattering class, the chattering class being middle class, the consumer class, the people who frequently go to shopping malls and frequently attend theater and were more worried during COVID time when the theaters will start and when the shopping malls will start. That particular class of Aam Aadmi is different than the Aam Aadmi at, you know, far off.
At large. India. The Bharat Aam Aadmi.
So for that far end Aam Aadmi, there's nothing in the budget. For instance, the wages of the landless laborer who frequently go to Manrega, they are same while the prices have gone up. He has to go through that and he doesn't get necessarily the job there because everything has collapsed. The entire MSME sector, micro, small and medium industry sector has collapsed where these people work. In fact, the migration crisis in COVID clearly showed who is Aam Aadmi. According to government, there were 3 figures issued. In one of the press conferences, Nirmala Sitharaman ji said that there are something like 6 to 8 crore migrant workers. Economic and Political Weekly published an article saying that there are 14 crore people who are migrants. Now, imagine the difference is between 6 to 8 to 14 crores, whatever is the figure. Even if you take the conservative figure of 6 crores migrant, imagine their life. They were completely jobless and then they were given food, 35 kilo food grains per family per month. But I think that is hardly palliative. So I think it is not alleviation of poverty. Unless there was a plan to reappoint them into some kind of job. Now that Aam Aadmi, what is there for this Aam Aadmi? You have this, all the Awas Yojanas and all that. But finally the petrol and diesel prices are shooting up to 100 rupees. And that will have a snowballing effect on the rest of the economy. And that will have the impact on Aam Aadmi. So it may appear only as petrol and diesel. It's not petrol and diesel. It has a snowballing, cascading effect across, and that across finally touches Aam Aadmi.
And also the fact that, Kumarji, that lots of jobs were lost during the pandemic. And I'm not talking about just the MSME, even the companies who could afford, even the companies financially who could afford on their balance sheet, which is visibly seen, they have reserves, they have left, right and center, you know, cut rolled, cut back salaries, or either, you know, cut people. Now it is a big challenge for even the government and for them to get their jobs back.
No, actually, you know, Joseph Stiglitz, who is a Nobel laureate in economics, he has said publicly that unless those who are in the corporate sector and have done well when the economy was going, when the economy was going well, unless they are ready to sacrifice for this crisis, during this crisis, situation will not improve, it will only worsen. And what we are finding is, I can tell you from the media, in the media sector, at least I know directly, because I have been in the media for more than 45 years, nearly 50 years, as many as 1,000 jobs have been lost. Yes. In just a matter of 1 month, in last so many editions have folded. So many journalists or non-press employees have been told to give up salary or reduce salary. So many of them. I cannot name the newspaper organizations here on the channel, but I can tell you leading newspaper organizations, leading media organizations have sacked large number of people. They have become jobless. And you know, those jobs are such, they are essentially in the age group of 25 to 35 or sometimes 25 to 40. Now, in this age group, if they have had experience on channel or in the newspaper for, say, 5 to 10 years or 15 years, they cannot be employed in a bank or a school because their complete personality profile, the job profile, their training profile, everything is different. So when they become jobless, they become completely jobless. They are on the road. And if this is a situation here, it is also a situation in many other professions.
Absolutely. Now, let's talk about the farmer agitation. The center is continuously saying that the farmer agitation now is a politically motivated one. How much merit do you find in this?
No, in fact, you know, very interestingly, this particular agitation is not at all politically motivated. I'll give you a simple example. I'm in Rajya Sabha. When originally the ordinance was passed, there was virtually no noise. But that time, Parliament was not in session. It was in June they passed the, they, you know, issued the ordinance. When the Parliament began and when the protests in Parliament began, it is not as if all parties joined the chorus. There were subdued supporters. There were not so subdued opponents. But it was not as if it will build up into an agitation. Farmers began their own agitation. In fact, if you recall, when the Akali Dal minister resigned from the cabinet, it only gave headlines and it gave a little bit of support to her and said that it is extreme action by her and actually she should have negotiated with the prime minister, she should not have resigned. So it began with that. But even then, Akali Dal did not withdraw its support to NDA. Akali Dal did not withdraw its support to Modi government. Akali Dal did not say that unless you withdraw the acts, we will not support you or we'll support you. Nothing like that happened. So even the party which was affected most in Punjab, Akali Dal, even they did not take a strong political action. NCP did not take a strong political action. In fact, when Congress and DMK walked out, NCP and CPM walked out from Rajya Sabha, I was there, NCP and some other parties did not walk out with us. And today we find these parties or many parties are supporting from outside. They were not supporting from inside. They were not building the agitation. They were not mobilizing people. They were not organizing farmers. All the farmers were mobilized and organized by various, something like 400 plus farmer organizations in different parts of the country, but primarily in the north, mainly in Western Uttar Pradesh, Punjab and Haryana. But about 400 to 500 farmers organizations were, you know, actually brought into action. And when they started mobilizing initially, it was like, you know, Shaheen Bagh operation. It was not so many people. Initially, very few people. Then it began to swell. Then it began to swell and they became about 50,000 to 60,000. That's how it began expanding because at earlier point, they thought that with this demonstration, which went on for about, say, a fortnight, immediately in November, late November, that government will invite them and discuss with them. At that time, the voice of the farmers was most strident and so stubborn and so adamant and so firm in conviction that withdraw the acts. And I can tell you by direct personal experience, these bills were actually bulldozed. When we walked out, and some of us went into Dharna near Gandhi statue, and some of us did not support. They actually bulldozed, passed the bills into acts without taking any division of vote, without taking any formal multi-party debate, and they just said everything is passed because they had the majority. India had the majority. And when constantly the opposition parties, not only Congress, opposition parties are saying that please send the bills to select committee. And select committee will choose what to be done. And you can, in any case, even in select committee, they would have had the majority. Because the government would have passed even select. But they did not approach even select committee. They did not accept the simple suggestion of going to select committee. And finally, what Supreme Court did? Supreme Court said appoint a committee and put the thing in abeyance for 1.5 years. So that is precisely what the opposition was saying. But what Supreme Court did, it appointed a committee of protagonists. It did not appoint a committee which is neutral. As a result, that committee was a damn squib. It did not.
So you're essentially saying that even the Supreme Court judgment is of no respite.
Naturally, because Supreme Court appointed committee members, and even one committee member from that committee also resigned, saying that he is supporting the farmers.
Now the government is saying that, for 18 months, we will put it at abeyance. Government is saying.
But still,
the farmers are taking the issue too far.
Yeah, but they can say that if you're taking it 18 months, take 18 months more. And then comes 2024.
But now if the government is saying that, let us know the changes that you need. Let us know any amendments that
It is not the changes.
But the farmers asking a repeal of the laws. Do you feel that the law
itself has been passed. The act has been made without proper parliamentary procedure. What is parliamentary procedure? You present a bill. Actually, you present the bill in advance to all the opposition parties and everybody in parliament. Then you have a discussion on it. After discussion, you send it to standing committee or select committee. When select committee, you can give sort of a time frame that let select committee give its judgment in 15 days, 3 weeks, 4 weeks or whatever. They could have given that. They did not send it to select committee. They did not allow the debate. They bulldozed it and passed it by voice vote after we have left. And so they are not even followed the parliamentary procedure. And finally, when Supreme Court says appoint a committee, they appoint a protagonist committee. So no parliamentary procedure was followed. And even the Supreme Court, the way it gave the judgment or the way it gave verdict about it, is clear that it was all kind of hatchet job.
Now, Kumarji, the Congress party says that the nation's democracy is under threat. The BJP says that democracy least exists within the Congress party itself. How do you respond to it?
I think there are two different issues. Democracy inside the Congress party is not the same as democracy as a part of governance. We are talking two different things. Is there democracy in RSS? Is Mohan Bhagwat elected? If Mohan Bhagwat was elected, who stood against him in the RSS election? So RSS, which is a main ideological and guiding force of the BJP, and entire core, top core, is an RSS apparatchik. Modi, Amit Shah, Rajnath Singh, everybody is an RSS apparatchik. So they come from an organization which is least democratic. So they should not teach democracy to Congress, but that is a different issue. The point is, democracy is not there in RSS, and the same system they are following here. There it is Eka Chalakanu Vartitva. Here also it is Eka Chalakanu Vartitva. Actually, privately, many members in the BJP say, that is, members in the parliament say that they are not even consulted on any issue. There is no discussion. And many ministers privately, I cannot name them, say that we are just given what is to be said. What is the policy? We are not told or we are not discussed with any policy by the prime minister. Demonetization was not known to 99% of the cabinet. It's such a major policy issue like demonetization was not discussed with the chief economic advisor, Arvind Subramanian. He did not know about demonetization. And he locked the cabinet and said, now you keep quiet and listen to the television's address by Prime Minister. And that is how he had announced demonetization. Is this democracy? Forget democracy in Congress party. And actually, you must have read so much about the letter of protest by 23 senior Congress persons. That is more. Have you heard any such thing even remotely? Even remotely in Jansen or in BJP or NDA, have you even remotely heard intra-party democracy. Acha, even the BJP president, Nadda, for instance, against whom he was elected, he was also nominated by Amit Shah. Was an election for the BJP president. They are saying that Congress president should be elected. Okay, fine. But is BJP, who is BJP to teach democratic norms to Congress party? And that is a different issue. Congress party is not governing the country now. Congress party's internal governance is its internal affair of its, they are responsible to their internal constitution. Similarly, BJP. I cannot tell BJP that you must have an election in place of Nadda. They can say that we nominate our president. Okay, fine. You nominate your president. But don't compare the governance of a country with governance of a party or inside within affairs of the party.
Now, Kumarji, a lot has been also, now since we've touched upon this topic, a lot has been talked about in media as well. And as you mentioned about the 23 signatories to the letter, regarding the overall structural overall of the Congress party at a leadership level, what is your response to it? I mean, a lot has been talked, but a lot of outcome is yet to come of it.
Yeah, I agree. But even Congress party agrees that a lot of outcome needs to come. Organizational network needs to be redefined. In fact, if you read, I don't have the copy now, if you read Rahul Gandhi's letter, when he resigned from the presidentship, you will find all the points that were raised by those 23 so-called rebels. They're there, that Congress party is not functioning properly. We are losing election and the blame is apparently on the family. And therefore, I'm resigning. And not only I'm resigning, I would suggest that nobody from the family should become president. And let you elect a president from CWC. He submitted the resignation to the CWC. That is Congress Working Committee. There are about 30 plus people there. Now, he told them, you elect another president. You choose somebody from the CWC or anywhere else. You choose somebody and let the party go on. He waited for 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, 1 year. They have not chosen anybody.
Why?
Why they have not chosen? Now, it is, you cannot say that is a dictatorship. When Rahul himself...
Forget dictatorship. I'm asking why they have not chosen.
They have not chosen because they are not confident about their having All India appeal. And somehow, historically, it has come to a situation that Nehru Gandhi family has an appeal across the country. Now, that complex may be there. They may be realizing that they don't have the kind of appeal.
Then how to solve this? No, from the Gandhi family, it has been seen that, as you mentioned about Rahul Gandhi's letter, that he mentioned that no one should from the family should be made. You all select a president. Now, if they are not selecting, considering the fact that no one has that kind of length and breadth.
They have not said that. Nobody has said that they don't have an appeal.
How this paradox will be solved?
I don't think. I think paradox can be solved only by in this June by electing somebody as a president. And because intellectuals like Ramchandra Guha and Harish Khare have said that not only from the party, but from politics, Sonia, Rahul and Priyanka should retire. Now, that is okay for intellectuals to say something like this. But is Ramchandra Guha going to lead the party or Harish Khare going to lead the party or Sanjay Jha is going to lead the party? Who is going to lead the party? Party is there. Then only suggestion, in fact, is dissolve the party. Okay, who is to dissolve the party? I mean, this is, kind of begging the question all the time.
A dissolution of a party, for a party which has been in the past 60, 65 years.
And dissolution of the party was recommended, according to some, by Mahatma Gandhi in 1947 after independence. But actually, that is also an incorrect historical statement. He has not said like that. He has only said that for independence, Congress was the main force. Now that we have achieved independence, the focus and the role and the responsibility of the party changes. So it must undergo a change. That was
more on governance then. It should more than independence. It should now govern. Now we have got it. Now govern.
Yeah. That was
the issue. Now, Kumarji, if we talk about, media space, the news space, you're a veteran journalist, you're a thespian. Many journalists recently, we have been seeing that some have been sent to jail or an FIR has been registered. How do you react to this?
I think there is a lot of fear psychosis in the media, and that fear psychosis comes from multiple sources. Multiple sources in the sense that some of the newspaper channels or television channels, they are threatened by Enforcement Directorate, Income Tax, and many such authorities by questioning. Now you are in business for such a long time. You are also MBA. You have studied London School of Economics and so on. There is No company in the world, forget India. India is known for having its black money operations and corruption and all that. No company in the world can survive and can sustain itself by minute micro questioning by the authorities. Because everything can be insinuated. Everything can be alleged. Every small thing, even a traffic offense, so many companies handle so many multiple affairs. Till today, they have not arrived. America has not arrived. How to deal with Facebook, how to deal with Microsoft, how to deal with Apple. They have not arrived at the conclusion so far. How to deal with Bill Gates and so on and so forth. So it is not easy for any company to conduct itself at every single micro level in a quote unquote legal and ethical manner. There will be some unethical business, not unethical business as such, but so which can be attributed as unethical. Now, here the threat in India to many companies, media companies, is of enforcement directorate from income tax and so many authorities. And then there is also a threat of revenue model. You are in the media business. Without revenue, no media organization can survive.
Absolutely.
Because ultimately, in Pakistan, a daily newspaper costs about 25 to 30 rupees. Because they don't have such advertisement support. So advertisements actually provide a kind of subsidy to newspapers and television channels. Now there are something like 300 plus news channels in India. 300 plus news channels. They require advertisement. No, advertisements are not there because economy is down. When economy is down, advertisements are not coming. That means revenue is down and still you have to run the 24/7 channel. How do you run it? So you become dependent on the government ads or government support. So naturally, you will be survived to the government so that at least that part of money source keeps coming to the channel or coming to the newspaper. So that is why you will find originally the Mann Ki Baat was supposed to be only for the school children and only on radio. And the schools were told that you must, have radio broadcast of Prime Minister. Now, Mann Ki Baat appears on every single channel, then it is next day on the headlines, and then again it is in the news whole day or 2 days. So, why does it happen? Why, wherever Modi is, whether he is in New York or Adelaide or Timbuktu, wherever, his speeches are heard by Indian media as if he is speaking somewhere in India. Modi is everywhere. His omnipresent, ubiquitous presence in all media. How come? Why? It is simply because all the channels, all the newspapers are dependent on government sources of finance, that is government advertisements. And therefore, they cannot give up government advertisements because private sector advertisements have fallen because the economy is in doubt. So naturally, they cannot hurt the government interest. They cannot destabilize the government. So they will follow what government likes. Government likes Rahul Gandhi to be destroyed as Pappu. Fine, we'll do that. Government will like Congress not to be covered. Okay, we'll do that. Have you, for instance, I'll ask you, Kalaji, one simple fact. Forget whether farmers are wrong or right. Forget whether they should have accepted the Supreme Court verdict of having abeyance, keep the abeyance and you go and start working. Forget they're right or wrong. Imagine 2 lakh farmers. Forget also the fact that they are middle peasants. They are not all poor peasants. Okay, granted that. But imagine 2 lakh farmers at middle and lower and higher middle level in this bitter winter of Delhi, on borders of Delhi for 2 months overnight. There are children, there are women, there are old men, old women. They're all there. Their cause may be right or wrong. But then the protagonists of the act should hold a counter demonstration at least for a week and show that they can stand in the winter. They can say that, okay, you are opposed. You are opposing it wrongly. And we are supporters of the country's economic interests. And we are defending the act. So we will also protest. Why they don't protest? Because they somehow know inside the BJP, there is a lot of discontent about these acts. Because the simple thing is, so many acts have been taken back by so many earlier governments, including British governments. If you recall, I was there in the Economic Times and I was covering it. Mrs. Gandhi had nationalized in 1974 food grain takeover by ordinance. And then because she had the majority, it was passed in Parliament. When I remember, all the traders, food grain traders, went on strike twice. In 1 week, they went on strike. I remember Viren Shah was the chairman of the agitation. When Mrs. Gandhi realized that this is likely to go against her, actually there were no elections coming that time. She realized that apparently this is not acceptable to a large number of people in the trade. She withdrew it. So it is not as if withdrawal hurts anybody.
Repealment has been done.
Britishers have withdrawn. Britishers have withdrawn in 1909, in 1927. And so many times Britishers, even the Indigo agitation in Champaran, Britishers relented after that. So government must be sensitive. Agreed, suppose government genuinely believes that the demands are wrong. Suppose government genuinely believes. They can say, okay, at present the tempers are high. We'll suspend it and convert the act. They are ready for amendments. They are saying that clause by clause we are ready to amend. So if you are ready to amend clause by clause, virtually you are changing the act, then withdraw the act.
Sure. Now if we talk about West Bengal, Kumarji.
Yeah.
West Bengal, you have TMC, you have BJP, and it's TMC versus BJP. You have an alliance with the left, but your party is nowhere between both of them. So in case a hung assembly scenario comes, where does Congress stand?
Not much. To be honest, Congress with CPM will not be able to make a dent as such, either in the Trinamool vote bank or the BJP vote bank. BJP vote bank is recent. BJP vote bank began after 2014, or you can say after 2012. So essentially, but it is a very interesting scenario, and therefore that algorithm is very difficult to break. That algorithm is such, those who are anti-Modi and anti-BJP, they are two different things. There are many people who are anti-BJP but not anti-Modi, and vice versa.
Vice versa, I mean, true.
There are some people who are pro-Modi but not pro-BJP, like that also they are there. So those who are anti-BJP and anti-Modi can have option of voting Congress CPM alliance or Mamata. But there is enough resentment against Mamata, let us say. So if there are people, voters who are anti-Mamata, they have again two options, Congress CPM alliance and BJP. Similarly, those who do not want CPM and Congress at all to come back, they have two options, either BJP or Mamata. So this is an algorithm which is very difficult to break. It is a triangle with not every angle with 60 degrees. So I don't think anything can be predicted. But however, one can definitely say...
Let's say TMC, BJP, votes come in such a manner, the tally, that without Congress, CPM, no one can win. So, aligned with the TMC as well?
Yeah.
Of course, you will not go with the BJP. You are not so aligned with the TMC as well. Then what will
Absolutely
happen?
Right. In such are absolutely a right. Time. That is my apprehension as well. I don't think anybody will get a full working majority.
Okay.
If you see, I will not compare Bihar with Bengal, but in Bihar also, BJP is not won hands down.
It's a wafer thin majority.
Yeah. Now that can happen in Bengal. Either Mamata can get a thin majority or BJP can get a thin majority. And if nobody gets a clear majority, it is distinctly a very hung kind of an assembly. So either there's re-election, or an alliance which we never thought of, like nobody thought of PDP-BJP alliance in Kashmir. Nobody ever thought of Congress, NCP and Shiv Sena coming together.
Yes. So can we see under Maharashtra?
Nobody ever thought. So everything is happening nowadays in a very strange manner. So I think Bengal may be another experiment.
There are chances we see a repeat of Maharashtra.
Yeah, distinctly possible. That opportunity is there even in Bihar now. Because there's a tremendous discontent in the JDU, among the JDU MLAs. Okay. So they are negotiating both ways. So BJP is trying to have its own full majority by getting JDU MLAs into BJP. And some JDU MLAs who are hostile to BJP want to join the RJD Congress. And you know, still the work going. I don't think situation will remain same for all 5 years in Bihar.
Sure. Kumarji, my last question. India has launched the world's biggest, largest vaccination drive. How do you respond to it?
Yeah, that is good. That's creditable to our scientists and medical fraternity. And the way it has been by and large managed as an administrative kind of system, I think it has worked well. And I think it is quite a point of pride for
indigenous vaccines, and out of which one Bharat Biotech is a complete indigenous.
So it is kind of
and they are even now in, they have an agreement with to give Covaxin to Russia, Brazil, as well as now to European nations. So a very proud moment.
I will not run it down just because I happen to be in the so-called opposition party or something like that. I think what deserves to be praised will be deserved.
Absolutely.
Will deserve to be praised. And one thing I'll definitely not appreciate, whether opposition or in ruling party, is the way they have handled the China border question. They could have handled that better. So while appreciating the Covaxin and the entire vaccination program, let us not presume that therefore all administrative systems or your subjective governance, rest of the governance is going well.
Both are separate. And
both are completely separate.
Okay. Thank you, Kumarji, for joining us. Thank you so much for joining us on this episode of Visionary Talk. It was a complete pleasure, you know, interacting with you on a wide variety of issues. Yeah. Really, it has been a pleasure. And thank you so much, ladies and gentlemen, for also joining.